welcome to In Depth. I'm Tina Jha. All of us are aware of the digital revolution India is undergoing. With easy access to the internet, there's been a sharp increase in digital transactions as well across the country. Today, more people living in semi-urban and rural areas are part of the banking and financial system than at any time since independence. And this is facilitating the direct transfer of subsidies and other funds to crores of beneficiaries. But this is only one side of the digital banking story. The increasing digital adoption has also led to rapid online payment fraud. Data shows the volume of cyber fraud at banks has doubled in a year. According to a report by the Reserve Bank of India, a total of 2,059 cases of cyber fraud were reported in the year 2017-18, amounting to 109.6 crore rupees. The number of cyber fraud cases in 2016-17 was 1,372, amounting to 42.3 crore rupees. Studies show that one in every four customers is a victim of online fraud in India. The latest to fall prey to such a fraud is former Chief Justice of India R.M. Lodha, who was duped of 1 lakh rupees after the email account of his colleague was hacked. Today's In-Depth looks at why are cyber fraud cases in banks spiking? How can we protect ourselves from digital banking fraud? And what is the government doing to ensure better security of the digital banking system? We truly want to believe that the internet is a safe place where you cannot fall for scams. But every once in a while, cases emerge acting as a reality check. The most recent is the case of former Chief Justice of India, R.M. Lodha, who was cheated of 1 lakh rupees in an online scam after the email account of his friend, also a retired judge, was hacked. Meanwhile, acting on Lodha's complaint, the police has registered a case under relevant sections.
Former Chief Justice of India R.M. Lodha was recently cheated of 1 lakh rupees in a case of online fraud. The incident came to light when Justice Lodha filed a complaint with the Office of the Assistant Commissioner of Police EOW and Cyber Cell in Delhi's Malviya Nagar Police Station. According to a complaint lodged with the police, Justice Lodha said he received an email from his ex-colleague Justice B.P. Singh on the night of May 19th. Lodha says he and Singh used to regularly communicate via email using the same email IDs. In his FIR, Lodha states that he received an email from Justice Singh requesting urgent financial help. The email also specified that he should respond via email only as Justice Singh was unavailable on the phone. He said he saw the above email at around 3:30 a.m. and replied to it. At 3:51 a.m., Lodha said he received another email stating that Justice Singh's cousin was suffering from acute lymphoblastic leukemia and they were short of funds. Lodha said the email requested him to transfer money directly to the surgeon's bank account. He was requested to send 1 lakh rupees. Justice Lodha deposited the amount into the said account via two transactions of 50,000 rupees each. However, on May 30th, the retired Chief Justice said he received an email from retired Justice Singh stating he was unable to log into his account as it was hacked by some miscreant. When the former CJI read Singh's email, he realized he had been cheated.
These kinds of scams have been existing on the internet for the last almost 1.5 decades. But they have been pretty much focused and targeted in their approach. So, if we do not want to become a victim of these kinds of scams, it's imperative that we need to be more cautious and careful. So, a couple of thumb rules, cyber hygiene habits have to be followed by us in our day-to-day lives. Number one, we do not need to trust whatever we read online or what we read on our email. Plus, always go for independent physical world, actual world corroboration. Number two, do not transfer any money without being absolutely sure that the money that you're transferring is for the specific purpose that you want to transfer. Number three, you should always, as far as possible, make it a thumb rule never to respond to an email which asks you to transfer money. Because anybody who's in trouble will first call you, but will not send you an email.
Acting on his complaint, the police registered a case under various sections of the IPC, including cheating and the IT Act. According to the police, the investigation is on and efforts are being made to trace the accused and the IP address of the computer which was used to hack the said email ID.
The whole issue of email scam can happen at two levels. One is individual emails can be scammed, so somebody's personal ID could be scammed. And the other way is corporate emails could be scammed. The corporate side is actually much bigger in terms of the fraud committed. In terms of numbers, approximately 90,000 crore rupees equivalent globally, 90,000 crore rupees equivalent per year have been stolen from different bank accounts through different people by all kinds of email scams. So it's a huge problem. And over the past 2 years, email scam, the volume of email scam has grown by 5 times. So this is a huge business, a black business, which a lot of people are doing across the globe. The advantage which an email scamster has is the fact that he could be sitting miles away in a different time zone, different country, different set of laws, and committing those crimes in an entirely different, on the other side of the geography. So that's how email scams originate, and they have been a global crisis.
Justice Lodha had served as the 41st Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of India and retired in September 2014. The Justice R.M. Lodha-led panel is widely known for its recommendation for structural reforms in the Board of Control for Cricket in India. With inputs from Leena Sharma, Bureau Report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Internet fraud is the use of internet services or software to defraud victims or to otherwise take advantage of them. Internet crime schemes steal millions of dollars every year from victims and continue to plague the World Wide Web through various methods. In this report, we discuss about the various methods through which these online frauds are conducted.
Fraud that is committed using the internet is called online fraud. Online fraud can involve both financial fraud and identity theft. Financial fraud and identity theft can be separate or related crimes. Identity theft happens when a person's identity is used to commit, aid or abet any unlawful activity. Often financial fraud can lead to identity theft. For example, an offender may send an email to a victim pretending to be from a bank and ask for the victim's bank account information. If the victim releases that information and the offender drains the victim's bank account, a financial fraud has been committed. The offender may then also use the victim's personal information to create additional bank accounts through which money is laundered or to open additional credit cards. This is called identity theft.
Email scams themselves can happen in multiple types. The most common type, so there's a chain of events which happen. First, there's a phishing event. Now, phishing event can also be done over a WhatsApp or a social media. Of course, it could be done over an email as well, where somebody gets an email saying that you won a lottery or the government is giving free solar panels. These days, that scam is also going on. Or the government is giving free mobile phones. Just register yourself and somebody asks your data. So they'll ask all the data, name, address, telephone number, and they'll ask you to give emails of 5 different friends and then only you'll be eligible for this lottery. Most people fall for this. And once they fall, these friends, then there's an identity theft. Now the person has their name, their address, their telephone number. So the identity is partly stolen. That identity is used to create a fake email, which then goes to the friends which have been recommended, saying that now I'm in an emergency, I'm in a hospital, my passport is stolen, I'm in a foreign land, pay me the money, I need to get out of this situation. So that's how email scams happen. So first there's a phishing mail which steals the data. Then there's an identity theft where somebody else, you know, imposters that person and then sends it to other people asking for help in terms of money.
Several high-profile methods of online fraud include the following. Business email compromise is a sophisticated scam targeting businesses working with foreign suppliers and companies that regularly perform wire transfer payments. The scam is carried out by compromising legitimate business email accounts through social engineering or computer intrusion techniques to conduct unauthorized transfer of funds. Data breach is a leak or spill of data which is released from a secure location to an untrusted environment. Data breaches can occur at the personal and corporate levels and involve sensitive, protected, or confidential information that is copied, transmitted, viewed, stolen, or used by an individual unauthorized to do so. Denial of service is an interruption of an authorized user's access to any system or network, typically one caused with malicious intent. Email account compromise is similar to business email compromise. This scam targets the general public and professionals associated with, but not limited to, financial and lending institutions, real estate companies, and law firms. Perpetrators of EAC use compromised emails to request payments to fraudulent locations. Malware or scareware refers to malicious software that is intended to damage or disable computers and computer systems. Sometimes scare tactics are used by the perpetrators to solicit funds from victims. Phishing or spoofing, both terms deal with forged or faked electronic documents. Spoofing generally refers to the dissemination of email which is forged to appear as though it was sent by someone other than the actual source. Phishing also refers to as wishing, smishing, or farming is often used in conjunction with a spoofed email. It is the act of sending an email falsely claiming to be an established legitimate business in an attempt to deceive the unsuspecting recipient into divulging personal sensitive information such as passwords, credit card numbers, and bank account information after directing the user to visit a specified website. Ransomware is a form of malware targeting both human and technical weaknesses in organizations and individual networks in an effort to deny the availability of critical data and/or systems. Ransomware is frequently delivered through spear phishing emails to end users, resulting in the rapid encryption of sensitive files on a corporate network. When the victim organization determines they are no longer able to access their data, the cyber perpetrator demands the payment of a ransom, typically in virtual currency such as Bitcoin, at which time the actor will purportedly provide an avenue to the victim to regain access to their data.
Typically, there are a variety of cyber frauds that exist. Invariably, there's one common minimum denominator, and the denominator is trying to win the trust of the target and then trying to force him or coerce him or influence him to part with money with his own volition. Now, invariably, it's targeted at people whom are believed not to be very tech savvy. Also, a lot of people who are normally very trusting become victims of these kinds of cyber frauds. But invariably, the frauds are targeted against individuals, they are targeted against banking organizations and other corporate organizations, and to a large extent, some of these frauds are even targeted at governmental departments, all aimed at somehow gaining access to money.
Frequent instances of internet fraud include business fraud, credit card fraud, internet auction fraud, investment schemes, Nigerian letter fraud, and non-delivery of merchandise. The rapid growth of e-commerce has created a fertile ground for online fraud and deception. Cybercrime is a constant threat, and even though it does not represent a physical threat in the form of someone trying to break into your home, it can be just as damaging. With inputs from Leena Sharma, Bureau Report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Spike in cyber frauds is bigger than most other types of bank frauds. As per the Reserve Bank of India, a total of 5,917 bank frauds were reported back in 2017-18, and nearly one-third of these were cyber frauds. The central bank is now on the verge of setting up a compliance and tracking system portal to tackle the proliferation of cyber fraud and also seeks to establish a better redressal mechanism for consumers. Other than registered banks and NBFCs, the proposed online portal would also address cybersecurity complaints from all regulated entities, including the prepaid payment instruments and mobile banking interfaces, as directed under the Internal Ombudsman Scheme of 2018.
Online payment fraud is a reality of the internet age we live in. And with the increasing digital adoption in India, the number of such fraudulent cases is only set to go up. According to a survey, Indians are among the most frequent victims of online banking frauds. A global survey conducted by FIS, a financial services technology firm, showed around 18% Indians who were surveyed reported a fraud in the preceding year. A major portion of frauds affected Indians between the age group of 27 to 37, the most regular users of online banking channels. Another report by Experience Digital Consumer Insights in 2018 showed that 1 in 4 customers is a victim of online fraud in India, while 24% Indians directly experience fraud while transacting online. The study by Experian and International Data Corp said the fraud risk in India is currently pegged at 8.1 points, second only to Indonesia, which has 8.7 points, and significantly higher than the average 5.5 points in the Asia-Pacific region. As per a report by the Reserve Bank of India, a total of 2,059 cases of cyber fraud were reported in 2017-18, amounting to 109.6 crore rupees. The number of cyber fraud cases in 2016-17 was 1,372, amounting to 42.3 crore rupees. The staggering number of fraud cases can be understood from the fact that during a six-month window between April to September 2018, the Reserve Bank of India registered a total of 921 cases of fraud related to debit or credit cards and internet banking, involving an amount of 1 lakh rupees and above. This is the reason why banks put up disclaimers announcing that their employees do not ask you for sensitive data. And that's precisely why you should never reveal details like your OTP to an unknown person.
Any request on email to transfer money should be completely disregarded. For we must keep the cyber security of our systems high. Must constantly have strong passwords, which must be alphanumeric. There must be alphabets, there must be numbers, because these kinds of passwords are normally difficult to be hacked. And finally, we must adopt cyber security and due diligence as a way of life. We should not expect that the government is going to be coming to our rescue in case if we make some folly and we land up losing any money. If we land up losing any money thanks to our negligence, we will have to be responsible for the same. Hence, if we can be more careful, cautious and duly diligent in our day-to-day cyber hygiene methodologies and habits, that could substantially help us not becoming victims of these kinds of cyber crimes.
Experts believe online fraud will remain a contentious issue even in the days to come. The more we connect and transact online, the bigger the threat. The only way to prevent online fraud is through vigilance and regulation. For example, the 3D secure protocol that was developed to keep customers safe. A similar process is the 2FA used in India, which is mandatory for all cardholders and card issuing banks. The RBI has also mandated online alerts for all card transactions, even those where the cardholder physically swipes their card at a POS system. For all transactions considered suspicious, cardholders have the option to issue a deactivation request immediately and hotlist their cards. The Ministry of Home Affairs also has a designated nodal agency for dealing with phone frauds. Besides, the prevailing cyber laws in India touch almost every aspect of transaction and activity involving the internet, World Wide Web and cyberspace. In the year 2000, the IT Act was formulated to provide a legal framework which accorded legal sanctity to all electronic records and activities carried out by electronic means. Through this act, amendments were made to the Indian Penal Code 1860, the Indian Evidence Act 1872, the Bankers Books Evidence Act 1891, and the Reserve Bank of India Act 1934 to bring them in line with the provisions of the IT Act. The IT Act of 2000 was amended through the Information Technology Amendment Act of 2008 in order to provide additional focus on information security. It also added several new sections on offences, including cyber terrorism and data protection. Incidents of cyber fraud and cheating were brought under Section 420, webjacking under Section 383, and email abuse under Section 500 of the IPC.
So the most common precaution is actually common sense itself. Anything which appears too good to be true is actually too good to be true. So don't believe in things like a lottery scam, or there's a Nigerian email scam which is going around, which is saying that there's somebody who needs a business partner in India to transfer some funds from Nigeria to an Indian account and they can do profit sharing. These kind of things appear just too good. So just don't fall for such lottery scams. Life is not this kind. right? The other thing is one should use, there are anti-spyware, anti-spamware softwares. You should be, Google itself has it, but if you feel that as a commercial entity, if you're getting spams, it's not bad idea to invest into anti-spamware, anti-malware software.
The government is also working towards adopting the blockchain technology, which will ensure greater security in digital transactions. The peer-to-peer network of blockchain development hashes transactions for being time-stamped into an ongoing hash-based chain of proof of work. This innovative mix of tried and tested technologies such as cryptographic hash functions, public key cryptography can enhance the security of e-wallets. With inputs from Leena Sharma, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
So preventing ourselves from being duped is the safest option. Easy access to victims is the reason why they are readily stalked by fraudsters. In our next report, we give you details on how to safeguard yourself from being cheated.
Your easy accessibility attracts fraudsters. Easy access to victims is the reason why they are readily stalked by fraudsters, whether while you are using a smartphone or a computer, are logged into social media or pay bills online, buy gadgets from an e-commerce website or withdraw money from the ATM. Preventing yourself from being duped is the safest option. You need to protect yourself from omnipresent scamsters.
A common error which is made is you'll see errors in terms of spellings, in terms of words in the text which goes in the email, which are a giveaway. So often they fake as different companies. For example, there have been cases where free air tickets were being given by a certain company and the company's name was misspelled. So pay attention to those little errors. The fourth thing is don't forward stuff. If you don't trust an email, if you know it's a phishing email, if you know it's marked by Google as well, or your whatever email server you have, just delete it. Why do you need to open it? So, just keep yourself secure. Don't believe into stories which appear to be just too good. Don't click on links which give away free lotteries and free solar panels and free money and free mobile phones. There's nothing free. You have to pay for everything in the world. And you invest in a good anti-spamware.
Here's a list of things that one should keep in mind while being online. Before making any payment for the purchase of an item on any e-commerce website, you have to make sure that the website, seller, and payment modes are secure. If you want to try out new websites, make sure to check their domain names. Ensure that the URL has HTTPS and not just HTTP and a lock icon. Also, always check the website's spelling. You could also check the company's trust rating on www.scamadvisor.com, which will give you all the details about the firm and how safe it is to shop from there. As for payment, avoid direct payments to sellers. Opt for payment services, which ensures that the seller is not paid by the site till the product is delivered, thereby safeguarding your money. One has to be cautious while interacting on social media websites and conduct background checks before giving away money for a good cause. Beware of friends who ask you for money. The fraudsters could have hacked into your friend's account. In such cases, you may also not be able to seek redressal or have legal rights to reclaim the money lost because you either volunteered the money or information yourself. So the best you can do is to avoid strangers and expose yourself only to the people you know on social media. Don't give out any money without knowing how it is going to be used, and if you are sending money, do make sure to use secure payment channels. Banking fraud may be among the top online scams, and the RBI is in the process of reducing the liability of the consumer. According to the RBI, incidents of bank-related fraud, including cards, ATMs and net banking, have risen from 8,765 in 2012-2013 to 11,997 in 2015-16. Be alert, install protective features on your phone and computer, and educate yourself. Here are some steps you can take to avoid banking fraud. These include registering for SMS and email alerts, not disclosing details on websites, always hiding your CVV and going virtual, and do not save details on websites. Phishing and wishing are among the most prevalent of frauds to have emerged in the past couple of years. Avoid sharing personal details at public places like malls or shopping complexes on the pretext of holiday packages or gifts. Do not reveal your financial or personal details on application forms, phones, or emails. Remember that there is no legal recourse if you lose your money in this fashion, so stay alert and secure your hard-earned money. With inputs from Leena Sharma, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
So that's it from us in this edition of In-Depth. We'll be back same time tomorrow with a focus on some other subject. You can also watch our program online on YouTube and Twitter. And don't forget to send your feedback and suggestions about our program. Thank you very much for your time.